Welcome to the show known as Conversations with Ralph Walker. 2020 is upon us right now. Believe it or not, we're living in a new day and a new time. And it's quite interesting because a lot of great things have been taking place. For example, did you know that in the city of Monrovia, California, that they have a new city manager? Oh, Oliver left, packed his bags, and moved on. And you didn't know that? Oh, you probably was thinking the fire chief was the interim city manager. But guess what? I can stop all this talking because today I have in the studio the new city manager of Monrovia, California. How are you doing today?
Very well, Mr. Walker. Thank you.
All right. Tell the viewers your name, so I don't want to stumble and mumble over it.
My name is Dylan Feik. I've been the city manager here now since about October 2019.
All right. So some of them are wondering, tell us a little bit about your family.
I have a young family, my wife Kira and I. We were married about 11 years ago. We have three kids. They go to schools here in Monrovia. Preschool here at Monrovia, and when they're not at school, we're playing together as a family at Library Park or up at the Wilderness Preserve or Canyon Park.
So. All right, I can hear the kids saying, "Come on, Dad, say our names."
Oh, yeah. So my eldest is Gabriel. He goes by Gabe, Benson, and then my daughter Eden.
And your wife's name?
My wife's name is Kira.
All right, okay, gotcha. Include them all.
Yeah,
family.
Hopefully, most of you had the people here in Monrovia's had a chance to see them. If it's Friday night street fair, we're out and about. If it's the library or shopping in grocery stores here on Myrtle Avenue, you're gonna see us out all the time. So a lot of people have had a chance to see me and the family. We're the one with the rowdy bunch walking up and down the streets.
Okay, rowdy bunch. My family too. Who knows? All right, talking about family and all right, you. What were you doing before? What city? Where are you coming from?
Prior to Monrovia, I worked as a city manager in Calistoga, California.
Calistoga.
That's
where on a map do you find Calistoga?
Anybody who's been to wine country, to the best wine country in all of America, it's Napa Valley, California.
Oh, you brought me a bottle?
I didn't bring you a bottle, Ralph. I'll get you one. I'll get you one. Well, let's finish the interview first, all right?
Okay. It might enhance and make the interview better.
There you go.
Believe it or not. So, had you heard anything about a city called Monrovia prior to...
So, I knew about it. I had a good friend who works down here in the area, and I think I'd been to Monrovia once or twice passing through. I had heard...
Headed to where?
I was staying in Sierra Madre.
Oh, okay.
So not too far away.
Stone's throw.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Beautiful area. We love the mountains here. Mm-hmm. And so my good friend calls and says, "Hey, there's a position opening. Oliver's leaving. And, Monrovia is about as good a place to live mm-hmm. as you could ever hope for." So I did a little bit of research and came down and thought I'd hit the jackpot if only I could land this job.
Okay. Now, I'm pretty sure there's a young person out there, or maybe even a senior citizen wondering, how did you know that you wanted to get into politics or to be a city manager? What does it take? What type of education is needed for that?
So a city manager, a lot of people don't know that a city manager is not a politician. Elected officials, politicians, they're elected, voted on through a popular election here in Monrovia. But then those elected officials hire a professional manager to run the day-to-day business of the city. That's the city manager. Many years ago, I was going to school. I was living in Ogden, Utah, and attending Weber State. I was a Weber State Wildcat, small school. And I had a professor who was teaching an introduction to local government class.
What's his name?
His name was Gary Johnson. Mr. Professor Johnson asked the question, "Any of you know where your water comes from?" And, as a 19-year-old young man, I had no idea where the water from the faucet came from.
Okay.
And it kind of intrigued me. And by the end of the class, I went up and said, "This is, fascinating. Mm-hmm. Is there an internship? Something I can do, something I can try?" And the following day, I was starting my first internship working for a city manager. And, you know,
wow,
the rest
that's
is
amazing.
History. So, you know.
And who was that city manager?
That city manager's name was Duncan Murray, and he worked in a small town of Perry, Utah. And, you know, I spent a lot of time helping Duncan on various projects, rewriting municipal code, preparing information to build a new community center. I got to do ride-alongs with the police department.
Mm-hmm.
I got to learn finally about how water was collected, clean, distributed, so
yeah.
I could finally answer that one question, where does water come from? And I just, I felt such an energy with this idea that I could work for a city and make a difference in people's lives.
So what would be your, in your early life, what would be your most crowning moment that I got this, this is good, this is what I work to bring to the city? What any particular first victory, I'll say? Is that making sense to you?
Yeah, you know, I think every day is made up of small victories.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to recognize those and appreciate those, because you never know when it's your last day.
True.
But I think for me, the biggest, the most proud moment that I have professionally,
mm-hmm.
Probably is when I was in Calistoga. That's where I worked prior to coming to Monrovia.
Mm-hmm.
I was working there in October 2017 when the Tubbs fire started. It actually started just a few hundred feet right outside the city limits of the city, and quickly moved westward and, you know, burned right into Santa Rosa, burning over 5,000 homes. But there was also a portion of that fire which remained right there at the Calistoga city limits and burned for 7 days. So as a manager, you're watching this fire on the edge of your city, burning on the hillsides, and the wind was moving in every direction.
Mm-hmm.
It was moving up terrain, down terrain, and we finally had to make the decision to evacuate the city. So
what was the population of the city?
Population of residents, about 5,200 people.
Quite a bit.
But it was also the busiest time of year as far as tourism industry. And in October, that's when they're doing the grape harvest.
Yes.
That's when all the workers are in the fields. That's when tourists from all over the world are staying in your hotels. So it was a very busy time of year. And having to evacuate a town, we, you know, long story short, after, you know, 2+ days of no sleep, we had to start knocking doors and physically approach every home and evacuate people and move them out of town. The fire, fortunately, never came south. We were able to, you know, return back to the community several days later.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a significant amount of planning, of execution. You have to have great teamwork, great
yeah.
people around, volunteers, everyone. A community never comes together more than when
crisis.
There's threat of a crisis
mm-hmm.
or an actual crisis.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one where I feel like it absolutely changed me as a person. It
mm-hmm.
changed me as a manager. And I was just so proud of the people I met, the experience I had. And it was so unfortunate for so many people. And there's not a day that goes by I don't think about them or their losses. And
mm-hmm.
it'll certainly be one of those defining moments
mm-hmm.
of my life.
Yeah, and the history of the city too.
Absolutely.
In so many different ways. So all right, you do a fantastic job there. You tell your wife there's an opening in Monrovia. There's a possibility that we may be moving that way. What was her reaction?
You know, both of us always wanted to live, work in a town where, you know, I was a manager and our kids could go to school. We've wanted, you know, historic feel.
Mm-hmm.
We've wanted to be close to the mountains.
Mm.
And my wife, a marine and aquatic biologist, loves the ocean.
Oh, okay.
We've always wanted to be in the metro and as far away from the city as we could, right?
Yes.
So when you add all these things together, and I mean, Monrovia is just the perfect place
mm-hmm.
for us. And so, you know, she was almost as happy as I was.
Okay.
But we have felt like we are floating on clouds for the last couple months.
Okay. Still going through that honeymoon period in Monrovia. The most enjoyable thing about Monrovia that really made you say, yes, this is the place. Any particular sight or sound?
You know, this I'm going to give a site. I got two items. So the first, the site, Wilderness Preserve.
Oh.
We as Monrovians have had the foresight and the vision to purchase that hillside years ago and make that commitment. And I go up there at least a couple times a week. Last week I was up there three times in one day. That preserve is just an escape for me, for many people. And I don't think we appreciate, I mean, we could never appreciate it enough.
No.
It's just a beautiful, beautiful place. So I think that is one place I go that, you know, call it my happy place.
Yes.
It's wonderful.
Yes, yeah.
But I think the other thing about Monrovia that's so special is, you know, people here are proud to be Monrovian.
Yes.
They move here and then they don't leave. Mm-hmm. They get involved, they volunteer, they go to school, they're passionate, they care, they want to associate with their neighbors. Mm-hmm. They do. It's a place where when I go to the grocery store, when I walk up and down, you know, any street here in town, people already are discovering who I am.
Right.
They call, hey, they wave.
Yes.
It's a very special community. It really is a community. And I think that that's just, it's unique. It's not found everywhere.
I was going to roll off that word, unique. I think the uniqueness of Monrovia is its size. It has like the perfect size. It's not too big, not too small. The children, a lot of them go to the same school and end up at two different high schools. But most of them end up at Monrovia High School. So it's a growing up period through that. And a lot of parents went to Monrovia High, so it's a lot of history. And Monrovia's politicians, you are able to approach them. They're not someone from a distance. You can actually approach them, talk to them, like you say, find them in the store. They'll engage in the conversation. Like myself, I come from the city of Chicago. There's no way in the world I would be approaching Dick Daley. Okay, back in those days when he was mayor. But Bob Bartlett, I got to approach him so many different times in different ways. It was like unreal. I don't believe this. I'm coming with my mic in my hand and it's KGEM, it's Channel 3, and I want to interview now. And he was very receptive, like even those that might have disagreed with me, still allowed me to put the mic in my hand and approach them and to give their direct conversation, maybe to my direct conversation. And the people love that dialogue because it was done in an intelligent manner. And that's probably what's given me so much longevity of hosting and being out into the community. So that's so vital. I think the size is like perfect. It's the perfect size. And the vision that takes place in the city of Monrovia, the leadership and how it developed in so many different ways with city managers coming in, given an opportunity to grow and to expand. So what is your vision for Monrovia? I'm pretty sure you have a vision. I'm here, I'm city manager. I know you're going to take your marching orders from the mayor and the city council collectively, but in the same breath, you have a vision too. Mm-hmm. So what?
You're absolutely right. So the mayor and the council are, you know, the governing body of the city.
Mm-hmm.
And they have a breadth and a depth of importance and decision making that is vast. Mm-hmm. And difficult. And if, you know, if anyone ever questions whether that's a difficult job, it's among the most difficult jobs that a community has. So they certainly set the tone.
Mm-hmm.
They certainly adopt from a policy perspective the direction that the city needs to go in. My job as a manager is to provide them advice, mm-hmm. counsel, perspective, provide them the information they need to make those best decisions. I think as a professional manager, the way I do my business is really that speaks to who I am, mm-hmm. and what my vision really is. So first and foremost, as a manager, I'm an ethical person. I conduct business in an ethical way.
Mm-hmm.
You know, people need honesty, they
right.
need integrity, and they need truth from the city manager. And if I am to advise council on matters of importance, you know, there needs to be trust. So mm-hmm. you'll see that in certain behaviors. I always act, behave in a certain way. But I think when it comes to leading the city, leading an organization of 296 employees, it's really important that you are their leader,
mm-hmm.
that you listen, that you demonstrate the values that the city of Monrovia has. Four key values: we're humble, we're hungry, we're loyal, and smart.
Mm-hmm.
I need to live and breathe those values every single day, and I do. And in fact, there's 296 employees who do.
Oh,
that's
yeah.
what we hire for.
Yeah.
And they're great employees. And I wanted so much to come join them to be part of their team.
Mm-hmm.
I think Monrovia, as colorful and as exciting of a past as we have, I think we have an incredibly bright
mm-hmm.
future. I love to think about how I could make a difference
mm-hmm.
and how I could contribute to the future. Currently, Monrovia has some exciting opportunities that we began planning for many, many years ago. Station Square is
mm-hmm.
a very common term, we all know. A
right.
lot of projects, a lot of housing
mm-hmm.
is being proposed near the Gold Line Station. That vision, that plan, was adopted originally back in the early 1990s.
Mm-hmm.
And here we are getting ready to see it
mm-hmm.
under construction. We have many commercial businesses
mm-hmm.
in the community that are growing, that are expanding, that need places to house their workforce.
So if you mm-hmm. were to bring one business or influence the city council and the mayor, one business that you would like to see on Myrtle, what would it be and why?
In-N-Out. No, I'm just teasing.
if
you know me, as I walk up and down Myrtle, people stop me all the time and say, when are we getting an In-N-Out? And so I joke.
Yeah.
Do you know, the thing about, you know, attracting business, to me the most important thing is that the city provides a climate
mm-hmm.
that is consistent and fair for every business. It's not my job to pick favorites,
mm-hmm.
to pick winners and losers. That's not my job. It should never be the city's job. But we should create an environment where any business can come in and, with playing through the same rules,
mm-hmm.
be successful. Monrovia is well known for the last several years in a row, been recognized by the Los Angeles Economic Development Commission as one of the most business-friendly
yeah.
cities in the county. Out of 88 cities, we're at the top of the list. We want to maintain that high level of customer service in everything we do. We're always looking at how to get better. So, you know, I think there's always going to be an opportunity for a new business to come in, and we want to make sure that when they do, or when a business wants to expand, add employees, or when someone just has a project in mind, I want there to be an opportunity for the city to participate in that dream making, whatever
mm-hmm.
it is. We should be aware of all the rules and regulations. We want to see projects that fit really well
mm-hmm.
within our community. And even when we reach out and try to attract a certain type of tenant
mm-hmm.
for a building, we want it to be something that fits in that neighborhood, in that location, where we're not putting undue pressure or stress on a commercial shopping center. For example, we wouldn't want to put a high density commercial facility on a portion of Myrtle Avenue
mm.
that requires hundreds of spaces of parking.
Mm.
We would
yeah.
want to be careful about what kind of retail we put on a place as important as Myrtle Avenue. So again, it's a fine line, and you know, we're constantly trying to create a place where it's good to do business.
So there goes in and out.
Well, on Myrtle Avenue, maybe we find another location somewhere.
Yes, yes, there's another location out there. All right, let's talk about the, how does a city manager, well, I always thought it was like two types of city managers. Now you tell me. The first type is one that's pretty dominant. They'll come in, there's a mayor, there's a city council, but then there's a city manager that sort of grabs the reins and sort of dictates to the city council and to the mayor, this is what you need, okay? And then there's the other type that sits back, listens to the mayor and the city council to tackle or what to take on. What type are you?
I like to think that I demonstrate a little bit of both in my style. First and foremost, you know, a manager is a leader. Yeah. Leaders elevate other people around them. Yeah. You know, my job is to, you know, work closely and support those people around me. And help them be the best they can be. Mm-hmm. You know, a chief of police, that's a very difficult job to do. And am I giving him all of my support, all of my help, and helping him be the best chief he can be? Mm-hmm. But he has officers, he has records clerks, he has a lot of people who help support him too. You know, so a manager's job, first and foremost, is to serve those other people around him. There are going to be times where the council looks to me for leadership and guidance too. You know, you have five elected officials. They all have different opinions. A lot of times they come together and agree on a common course. Sometimes they don't. They have a good dialogue, good debate, and they may have votes that, you know, represent disagreements, mm-hmm. even in the end. But they're always respectful towards each other.
And is that when you step in to make the call?
No, the city manager fortunately doesn't ever get to vote on anything. Okay. But what I can do
is he voices opinion and facts and data.
I do my best to lean on the facts, the opinions, and to provide them with sound advice that would be very helpful. So for example, that would be most helpful. For example, we had a discussion just last week about one of these housing projects near mm-hmm. the Station Square. It was a really good debate, and there were a few council members who disagreed with the height of the building. Mm. There were three council members who were okay with the height, and it was a simple disagreement. If the council was going to lean further towards rejecting the application, denying mm-hmm. the application, the city attorney or myself would provide information to city council about what further ramifications or impacts there could be if we denied the project. Mm. So for example, if council decides to deny the project, these are three or four or five possible consequences that could happen.
Which could cost the city money.
Which could cost the city money. They could cause, loss of a housing project that mm-hmm. brings 300 new housing units to a community desperate for more housing. Mm-hmm. There's a variety of impacts. So it's important that council is frank with each other and disagrees. And disagreement mm-hmm. is always okay. And it's important for city managers to, like you said, be able to sit back and listen, to hear what's being said, and to provide good guidance to them when they need it.
Have you ever given advice and it backfired? You didn't get the result that you really thought and you worked hard on it. I take it you're a guy that really does his homework. Has that ever happened in your journey as a city manager?
Absolutely. We all make mistakes, and you know, I don't like to point fingers at mm-hmm. whose fault it was, because there have been times where I was wrong. I think it's important that we recognize we can all make mistakes.
Yeah. How do you bounce back from it? Unless if something goes awry, and then the next day you got to walk back in that conference room and talk about moving forward, right?
You know, you have to check your ego at the door, and you can't...
People say that, but it's not always a reality, right?
It's not, and you know what? I'm really fortunate that I have the best job in the city.
Okay.
I get to be involved in so many cool and exciting projects, and even for me, it's really hard to check that ego, but it still has to be done. There are times where I have felt, even at my very core, that I was right. Oh. And if given a chance 100 times over, I'd make the same decision 100 times over. But it still may not have been the right decision. Mm-hmm. And I think for a manager, for me especially, you know, I'm constantly seeking feedback. I'm constantly asking my team around me, what do you think? Mm-hmm. What do you share your thoughts? I want your opinions. I'm trying to use them as sounding boards and guides, and you know it's in many ways it's made me a much better manager because of it. And I think it's something I want to continue doing day in and day out as a manager.
So all right, now as a city manager, it seems like they come to town and they have an expiration date, 3 to 5 years. And after that, it's sort of like, if you really do your job and the city really is under the spotlight and people hear that name, oh, Dylan, oh, yeah, they just hired that young guy. Look what they did. Oh, like Oliver. And then people come according and say, hey, don't you want to come work over here? A little bit more money and other little benefits to go. Is that just part of being a city manager?
It actually is. So I'm actually what's called a credentialed manager with the International City County Management Association. What that means is this professional organization has a code of ethics. It requires training. It requires we go through education to ensure that we are professional managers.
Okay. And
I've received my credential after challenging myself for many years. Well, the organization has a lot of information and record on the tenure of managers, and nationally it's more like 2 to 3 years is the average average lifespan of a manager in a city. There's probably many.
And why is that 2 to 3 year period? Dang, that was really nice. Five years?
Yeah. Oliver was here for a long time, right? I think he was here 5 years. It's a number of reasons. If you think about being a manager of a complex organization and having five bosses, all with different mindsets, all with different perspectives, but yet, how do you manage and lead a community where you also have, you have politics, you have emotions, you have developers and major dollars at stake. You have, residents of a neighborhood that feel like they're not being heard or listened to. You have seniors who feel like, they're not receiving the kinds of services that you might be providing in abundance to youth. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of stressful, items, issues, problems that come across a manager's desk day in and day out. So in addition to it being more money or maybe it's a beautiful location, it might be the challenges of the job. It could be wanting to reside closer to family. Mm-hmm. The original reason that I came from the Midwest to California was because I wanted to be closer to my family. Also, California was a place that I wanted to be a long-term city manager, whether it was because of the weather, the challenges, the politics. It was a place I wanted to be. So even though I worked in a phenomenal organization in Iowa, it was a perfect opportunity for me to come this way.
Too cold in Iowa.
Oh, I tell you what, there was I made the decision after 10 straight days with a negative 40 wind chill. And that's when we decided California's looking pretty good.
Okay. Oh my God, where do I go from there? Love you, Iowa. Okay. But it does get pretty cold there. All right, now how do you deal with that fabulous or that interesting or that big, huge elephant in the room? Hey, you know where I'm getting ready to go. How does a city manager deal with racism or sexism if it occurs in, let's say, a department and someone brings it to you, and do you take it to the city council? How does that play out?
It's a wonderful question. Racism continues to remain in our society to this day, in every community I've lived in. And it is something that, you know, maybe not always at my dinner table, but maybe it's my neighbor's dinner table where it still is discussed.
Yes.
And someone is concerned about their, you know, child walking to school or their father walking home from work. And I think the reality is, as a manager, I've learned that whether the discussion is going on at mine, being my dinner table, it is going on elsewhere. So it's important that we recognize it, that we talk about it, and that we make sure in whatever capacity we have, we're creating mechanisms and opportunities to address it when it exists. At the city of Monrovia, the city as an organization, we have clear policies and guidelines. The city does not tolerate racism in the workplace in any way. We also have other types of, I call them protected classes, but there are other forms of discrimination which are also not tolerable.
People with disabilities, which sometimes people forget. Someone that are mentally or physically challenged, they can hold a job. I once worked with an organization that provided job opportunities with people with disabilities, and it really educated me on, wow, they're still human, they're still capable of getting a paycheck. They might have some restrictions, but in the long run, oftentimes they're very good workers. I'll say that. So, you know, when you talk about racism and you bring it out, it's some people always, well, why you got to bring up that question? The conversation was going good until you brought that up, because there's a need for us as Americans to really have a healthy conversation about it and act on it, have some action on it, because after verbal it gets sort of old. I mean, you gotta do something, but I have faith in the young people today. They are expressing the need for change a lot better than some of us. I'll put it like that. Especially the young women. Young women are really on the move of taking on challenges in the workplace and wanting to be everything, even up to a president of America, which says a lot about progress and that continuous battle that takes place. Am I making sense?
Absolutely. I think in our workplace, I've been really fortunate that from the time I was first entering city management, the most influential person for me was a female assistant city manager. I look to her, and even to this day, I place her on that pedestal of professional admiration, that when I have questions or concerns, that I always look to her or think about how would she handle this. She provided so much more to the organization, just not only because she had 20-something years of experience, but she brought just a perspective that was admirable and valuable and so contributing to the success of the organization. And that was an organization of over 1,000 employees. So I think absolutely, you know, women, I'm gonna say minority, but young folks, anyone who is, you know, ambitious and is, you know, paying attention and seeing that changes are needed, you know, they should have places and opportunities to step into workplaces like the city and be able to be part of the change, be able to help drive the change. In my office, I have a wonderful staff. And if you look around the office, you know, many of the staff are young, Many of the staff are female. And, you know, if you think about the success that the city of Monrovia has had in recent years.
A lot of women have left their print.
Look who's helping drive the success. And you look at every department, and we have people, you know, so it's not just the young women, but we have people of all different backgrounds, experience, race, ethnicity, age, who are driving major changes for the city of Monrovia. It's exciting.
So what's the next thing on the list for you?
Next thing on the list, I think it's dinner, right? But I am so excited to be here in Monrovia. I'm excited to, you know, pursue my dream and continue my dream, which is to be a city manager. I think this is a wonderful community. I think we have so many exciting projects to think about.
And not just the city manager, but the best city manager that you can be.
Absolutely, absolutely. For the best city, I think we are truly the gem of the foothills, and there's no limit into what we can achieve. And I think it's an exciting place to be.
Oh, sounds good to me. All right. I think they're telling me it's that time moving along. And to the viewers, if you just tune in, I'm honored to have here in the studio the new city manager. Tell them your name, Dylan.
I'm Dylan Feik. I'm the new city manager for the city of Monrovia.
All right. So if they want to get in contact with you, how do they get in contact with you? There's a lady out there want to call you up right now to talk about a light on Lime Street, a left or right turning light. Say a name, boy. She's going to say I fought. Dorothy. I'll just give the first name. I'm pretty sure she's going to give you a call. So how do they get in contact?
Yeah, you can give me a call anytime. I'm at City Hall. I work long hours. I work long days. I have an email address. The first place I'd recommend everybody go is you can go online, cityofmonrovia.org. You can contact me.
There, get you direct?
Yep, you can get me directly. You know, whether it's send me an email, make a phone call, I always return the call. And I appreciate the opportunity to be here today.
All right. I got to gather a little information from you about the role of community TV. Now, you've had some background in that, right? Mm-hmm. Dealing with that?
Yep.
And you're also the liaison for KGEM now, right?
I'm one of them. I'm not sure that I'll always be the one forever,
But the one with the city manager.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Okay. Have you looked into KGEM, maybe hosting a show once a month or twice a month from the city manager's desk and giving some information on that? I talked about maybe you ought to do a table on at the street fair. Over 12,000 people pass through there. Getting your name out and let people get to know and meet you, as they always say, like in the flesh.
Yeah.
Okay, Prince in the flesh. So what is your background with community TV? Do you know the pros and cons? What's the blessing of having community TV?
Well, I think for me, one of the biggest blessings of community TV is that it provides wonderful education and information to the public. A lot of times, I think we underestimate the value of providing information to people in a variety of ways. You look at your subscription channels now, and there's just so much out there that is truly a waste of time.
Yes.
And when you know, whether it's KGEM, you know, there's other forms of communication. There's a lot of great ways to be involved in your community, to learn about programs that are going on right here in Monrovia. You know, to learn about people, to learn about stories, to learn about things that really make this community so magical. In my experience, we've had local TV stations in all of the organizations that I've worked for. It was necessary, even vital, that information was able to be shared with the public about what makes this community turn, to provide coverage of elections, to provide coverage of government. You know, to be the city manager in a city this size, the head of the local government organization, it's important that people have access, that they have information about, and that they're able to learn about their government. We're here to serve them, and KGEM does that.
All right, thank you so much. Okay. I'm honored that you made it here. Okay. You're gonna hear your wife right now saying, I thought it was supposed to have been over with sooner. So You can make that move, and this is a wrap. Until the next conversation, that's it.